we right?
A day to just go. Oh no, you can't do that.
What?
Just pack it. Yeah, no one's gonna come. Hello.
It's good to do your dance.
So, would you just like to introduce yourselves?
Go on, because you're better at...
I was just going to say, like, this is the cringe thing that we always do.
Hello,
I'm Tamar. And this is Jo. And together, we're Tamar and Jo.
Right, say it like a normal person now.
Okay, so we are Tamar and Jo, and we are a Hull-based dance company. We started working together in the back end of 2017.
And the majority of that time we've been working on our Doorstep Dances project.
Oh, yes.
Doorstep Dances started when we did a dance for our friend Michelle, who was isolating with health issues during the pandemic. And we thought we'd take her a birthday dance to Respect by Erasure to cheer her up, which is one of her favourite songs. So we did this performance for us as a complete surprise, and we just shoved these flowery dresses on and no special costume or anything, and just choreographed this really quick dance, like what you'd make in the playground when you're five. Went round to her house and did this dance for her, and then felt like there was potential for it to turn into a project. So we decided to do a menu of five dances for the first version last year. People could pick one of the dances. They were all choreographed in our living rooms and kitchens because it was during the pandemic. We couldn't get into a studio or anything. Quite simply costumed.
With quite minimal funding, but it just felt like we had to go for it.
Mm.
We did it, and the response was just quite overwhelming, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I think last year especially, because people were just so starved of connection and art and joy. So after the success of the summer project last year, we brought out a festive Christmas dance. And then because those, the summer and the Christmas performances went so well, we thought, right, we've got to apply for some funding to really, really do this project justice. And then we were successful.
I don't know if it looks right either, so that's not
so much. So,
what
am I doing?
They do smile,
they
like
do
really.
They
smiles, don't they?
They do look like psychopaths.
This time around, we had three pieces on the menu. We had Sink or Swim, which is quite a funny dance theatre piece, which is about two synchronised swimmers that go for a day at the seaside. And that came about because I had the idea of something to do with seaside, and Tamar had the idea of doing something to do with synchronised swimmers. And then we decided to put those two things that don't really exist together. So it was these two synchronised swimmers that everything they did at, like, typical seaside things would end up being synchronised, and it was quite silly, quite funny.
So these are the costumes that we've had designed by a costume designer called Lauren Pulford. So they're very colourful and ridiculous.
Are you just going like that now in all of them?
Going like what? Oh yeah, that's what I do, yeah. Let me check my book one second.
Definitely number
11. It says Collins on the door, so
yeah. Yeah, it is.
Thank you.
suddenly.
I can't believe it.
You, and then the fact that she's brilliant. She knows all about you, which is
like,
how
am I gonna know these girls?
Yeah. Oh, I'm so glad you enjoyed it.
That's brilliant.
That's probably been the most successful in terms of reaction from audiences on a large scale. That's the one that's been booked the most, I think, because as soon as you say something's funny, people want to see it, because it's it's, everyone likes a bit of humour, don't they? So so there's that one. We also, I really wanted to do something to do with rave culture or the 90s, so we did this sort of rave inspired piece
called Everybody in the Place.
That one was more just like bringing a bit of joy, wasn't it, really? I think a lot of people, when they watched that one, they said it's just like two people just on a night out having a real good time.
That we had on the menu is called Always.
So this one's definitely kind of the most arty.
Oh, there's Sean.
Wow. Oh. It was choreographed by Lea Anderson, so it's very rich. Like, she described the wanting to create something that was like a jewel for us, because it's only 5 minutes. Yeah, so it's really detailed, and when we made it, Lee used loads of images of kind of wrestlers, conjoined twins, and the whole sort of thing around the dance is the fact that we're like always connected. And there's a bit of a power struggle, but it's quite ambiguous as well, so people can read into it, you know, whatever they see, which is quite nice, because we've had quite a lot of conversations after we do this one, and people want to tell you what's it about, or I thought this, and that's quite nice.
It's the first time we've worked with an outside choreographer to make something on us, because we've always created our own work. And if anything, we are more likely to choreograph on other people. We've never had anybody choreograph on us.
Yeah.
So that's the first time we've done that. So that was... It was a really, really interesting process, wasn't it? And now we've got something that... We've got a piece by Lea Anderson, which is amazing.
Life in Hull as a dance artist is an interesting one. We don't have a huge kind of contemporary dance community here, so it's really useful for me and Jo that we embed ourselves within the wider artistic community, which is what we do. We like to collaborate with artists from different art forms, and we try to tap into a little bit of the dance community in Leeds, but mainly we're here in Hull, and we've just got a studio at Shirefarm House, which is a new thing set up by East Street Arts. So we are one of the lucky artists to be in Shirefarm House, which is this massive, massive old office block. Loads of different people have come in and set up studios in there. So it's really exciting for us as dance artists to be around visual artists, painters, animators, you name it.
The good thing that came from it was that we worked with three different designers instead, one designer for each piece. In fact, Lauren, who made these and designed these, also made the costumes for the Lea Anderson piece, but they were designed by someone in London, Charlie Wood. And then we worked with another designer, Rosie Whiting. She's based in London as well. So yeah, so now we've got three designers now that we know are good and that we've got some experience of working with.
I think that this project and how we've used social media to engage people with it further has been one of the really positive uses of social media.
at least five people said to me, oh, Jo, I saw your video this week with the dog licking Tamar's face. It was absolutely
brilliant.
That's right. I know you were there. Yeah.
It's gold.
And she comes in and gets it.
Brilliant.
These things that you've, when you can share stuff like this, when you've got video evidence of it, or even if you just talk about what's happened on social media, and you can have a bit of a laugh with people, and it's another way of people engaging with what we do. It's not just sharing the all the stuff that's meant to happen, it's sharing these things that you can't predict.
Not in. Not in.
What?
We've had this... luckily, we've not had it much because we have been quite... Well, we've been reminding people close up to the performance. But there's only so much you can do. You can only use the contact details that you've got to remind somebody.
Yeah.
But it's just been one of them days today. Tamar's got sun cream squirted directly into her eyeball.
Wow. By myself, my own doing, but I'm really struggling to see now.
On top of doing the community performances, we also did some pop-up performances. So we mainly stuck to the city centre and Pearson Park.
So what are you expecting from the good people at Hull?
I want people to laugh and maybe cheer. No, it will be interesting to see how this pop-up goes down, because it's just different when it's a captive audience and kind of people, you know, they have a certain expectation of what they're going to see.
Ooh. Right, so we have this one, and then we get a treat of dinner.
Yeah. We get a treat of eating.
Eating.
Oh, Tamar, we need makeup on.
Yeah, I was just thinking that.
Have you got your boobs on?
Just had absolutely loads of people watching each time, and some people that know us and have come along, and it always helped because our friends and family had, we'd promote it on our social media, so our friends and family had come along and set themselves up, and then because people had seen them congregating, they'd you'd get more people. When we dance, you have a way with me,
stay with me, sway with me. So we're going to Pearson Park.
Right. Oh, we've got a bit of an audience.
Days may not be fair. Always. Oh, just that everyone's there and it's really nice. Oh. Yeah. We're doing a performance over here if you want to watch. It's only 5 minutes.
That's true.
We were walking the dog across the park, sun shining, beautiful day, and we saw loads of people just over here. So we came across, and what a surprise. Tamar and Jo dancing. Everybody's just gathered round, really enjoying the sunshine, really enjoying Tamar and Jo. They're so entertaining, they're just brilliant.
I caught it, luckily, just as it started here in the park, and, you know, it just brightens the part of the day. Look at it. Anything like this really bringing, you know, the unexpected, you know, to the public, it's always good.
So how much time do you get between your performances to grab a bite?
Not long. Sometimes we get like half an hour.
In hindsight, we probably should have built in like in the middle of the day. A bit of a break. But we're just like, oh, an hour between every performance, that's loads of time. We're just like chilling.
I wanted to do them 45 minutes apart. Because I have no concept of time. But luckily we went with Tamar's suggestion of doing them an hour apart. But because in that time you've got to get all the stuff back in the car, often get changed, travel to the next one, which might be the other side of all, get all the stuff back out the car. So sometimes you just don't, you can have a few in a row where you don't get any time to chill at all.
When we did the 2021 version, we wanted to reach as many people as possible. So, and also by that point, things had relaxed, so there was no restrictions anymore, or very few restrictions. So community groups had started up again, and we had the ability to go and perform at quite a lot, in a lot of community settings.
The amount of people that we've met through this project has been amazing. And people who are just in their community trying to make a bit of a difference. Mm-hmm. And for example, there's this community garden at the bottom of one of the streets off Springbank, and we went and did a performance there, and someone who lived down there had a chalkboard on the on this little green area, and they've written Tamar and Jo here on Saturday, and they have like little workshops with the kids down there and teach them about the bugs in the garden. And it's just like normal people do, you know, doing stuff off their own back. And it was great to just meet all these, like, I wouldn't even call them like organisations.
No, they're just yeah, they're just grassroots little groups that have been set up by people that live in the areas that want to see improvements in the areas.
There was a little girl who must have been around 7 or something, and she came and sat right at the front, kind of where we were going to be dancing, crossed her legs, and just looked at us like this, and she said, I want to be a dancer when I grow up.
Tamar and Jo, we are so proud of this performance. It's wonderful. This is the whole Afro-Caribbean Association Center. It's the oldest black community, but all cultures are welcome. Yellow, black, blue, mauve, you're welcome. The performance was fantastic. Everybody was moved. Did you enjoy the performance?
Yeah!
What is it you
like
doing? We're doing a performance. So that's probably one of the very, very few negative reactions we've had from that woman. And a bloke came over at the end and just said, thank you, we really enjoyed that, despite other people. And that's, it's nice.
Yeah.
It's nice that no matter, like, you've always got something to counteract anything negative, because it's been so rare anyway, hasn't it?
Yeah. So we are performing for you the best, most spectacular, greatest show ever.
We were really pleased to be able to commission two local artists, Emily Ward and
Finley McGuigan and said to them, we'd love for you to come up with a performance piece of your own. And we put them on the Doorstep Dances menu for a one weekend, didn't we?
Yeah.
They did a combination of household performances and pop-ups. And they just made the most lovely, exciting show. And it got such fantastic responses.
Brilliant,
from audiences, yeah. Didn't it?
People loved it. So that's something that we're really, really keen to continue to do, to create opportunities for other artists as well, so it's not just us making work. What they see.
Sounds banging in there.
It does. Should we go in for a pint?
Right, come on then.
Looking back on it now, and even when we were delivering it, I think it felt great. I think people were really buzzing off it,
and it
felt like you was looking forward to going to each performance, even though you were knackered. It was exciting going to every performance because you knew that there was going to be a different response. The relationship between you and the audience was going to be different at each one. Some of them bigger audiences, some of them very intimate. But the conversations that we had and the feedback that we got and just even the physical responses, like people dancing along, and it's just really nice, all these things that have come from this project, and it's all thanks to the pandemic. If there's a project that's going to give you a lot of learning in terms of stuff going wrong, it's one where you drive around Hull in a little tiny car doing performances on the hour, every hour for 7 hours, with costume changes in between, in car parks and behind people's houses and whatnot. So, it's definitely offered a lot of learning opportunities.
Oh, God, look at the state of me.
So what did you say? You brought the noise?
You brought the noise. Bring the noise. God.
Right then.
I think I start saying more and more embarrassing, awkward things when I'm sort of digging deep for like the social aspect of it. Even though I'm still enjoying it, you do sometimes like run out of stuff to say, don't you? It don't come naturally, so you just start saying random shit.
Can't drink a can of Coke or any fizzy without burping.
I can't. Yet you don't burp in the piece when you drink it in the piece. You do a fake burp.
I feel like people might be offended by a real burp. Should I just do a real burp?